This program is brought to you by thepodcastfactory.com.
Canine crew, it's time to just sell the damn thing. Doberman Dan is revealing his contrarian formula for getting a rush of new customers, building your business faster, and making the highest possible profits. Go to justsellthedamnthing.com to get your copy today.
Prepare yourself for the uncensored, nothing held back, no BS reality of how business and life really work. Doberman Dan is off the chain.
I don't need to do my claps or anything like that, do I?
You got the clap? Dude, you shouldn't be saying that on the air.
That's a little too much sharing. It's caring.
You're a funny, funny guy. Jared, welcome to the show. Jared Eamon, ladies and gentlemen, entrepreneur, direct response / online marketer, copywriter, co-owner of Max Persuasion with Kendrick Cleveland. Welcome to the show, Jared.
Hey, Dan. Thanks for having me.
Also, Sir Jared of Eamon, one of the knights of my marketing Camelot. So let me personally tell you thank you for that.
Thank you for putting out the great newsletter. I just got mine today from vacation, and the first thing I did when I got home was read it.
Oh, well, thank you. People are going to think, oh, this guy's a shill. Dan put him up to that.
Yes,
I swear
yes,
to you, this was not set up. Oh, you schmuck, Jonathan. How dare you?
You know what? So, it was worth it. You got my name right. Thank you.
This is the first time in months I've called you by your real name.
All right. I'm going to mute out and let you guys talk.
All right. Well, just don't totally mute out. Feel free to contribute, especially when you hear me saying something stupid. Interrupt me and keep me from making an ass of myself like I usually do. So,
oh, no, we'll put reverb on that.
If I can, I was looking right before this call. I was looking for something online that would do sound effects on Skype because I was wanting to insert like, a trombone slide, applause, that kind of stuff. A slide whistle. Couldn't find anything. It's probably better that way.
Probably.
Jared, what's the backstory? How did you get into this world? Because I never hear from anybody. Well, I studied direct marketing in high school and then went on to, never works that way. Almost everybody seems to find it by pure dumb luck or by accident. Or in my case, desperation. How did you find your way into this stuff?
By dumb luck, just like you said. I was in college for marine biology, and this was probably 1994 to 1998, and I had a love for the ocean. That's why I went to University of Miami to study marine biology. I needed some money, so I became a scuba instructor. And I needed a way to get the word out there. So this was, I think, 1997 when I registered my first domain name, Scuba Miami. And I quickly learned how to put up a page and I started getting some response and kind of fell in love with it right from there. And I really got into SEO, trying to figure out how to get the website way, you know, on the top of Google. I don't even think there was anything called SEO back then when I first experimented with that. And from there, it kind of trickled down. After graduating, I kind of said to myself, what the hell am I going to do with marine biology? I kind of learned through going through school that you basically spend your life in a lab, and that really wasn't for me. So the internet was kind of booming right then, and I came up with an idea while sitting at a bar that wouldn't be great for a broke college students to have a place where they could find how to get drinks for free and and food for free. And I told a friend about it, and he introduced me to another gentleman who was actually an internet business developer working on one of the first wine sites out there. And that was funded by people from Cisco and all these other companies. And he loved the idea. So I flew out to California. where he was located. We started building the business. We had a handshake deal with CBS at one point because they wanted to use that type of property to promote their local news organizations. That's how they make money for the local news channels, is through advertising. And I thought it would be a perfect vehicle. So unfortunately, the collapse of the bubble burst at that time, and our deal was off the table. And I was like, well, what am I going to do next? And I got into consulting, and I started consulting with local businesses and helping them generate leads. So I built up a nice business, and from there, I kind of dove into copywriting and direct response marketing. It was kind of the next evolution from there.
You know, that's interesting. You might be the only guy I know who actually had a good business idea in a bar. Like, any idea I've ever had in a bar has been really, really bad. But that one was pretty darn good. Although it didn't work out like you expected, it was still a good idea.
Well, thanks. Yeah, it kind of led me, it definitely was the domino that fell and led me on to like a 22-year-old journey into direct response marketing and falling in love with copywriting.
Getting a website up and getting people to come to it and actually respond and start buying stuff in 1997, I mean, that was really... Those were the wild, wild west days of the internet then. That was cutting edge back then.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. I mean, it was just like you said, the wild west. I bought a book on HTML, threw up a really ugly page, and the phone started to ring. I'm like, wow, this is pretty damn cool. You know, I can write a few things and hit a button, and then people were booking scuba instructor lessons, and you know, I was able to pay my rent and eat in college, which is, you know, kind of important back then. So
just a little important.
Yeah,
I somewhat miss those days. I had my first website up in the bodybuilding market. It was either late 96 or the first part of 97. And the coolest thing about those days back then is, email was so novel that we just got such high open rates, and people read it and even waited for it, unlike now.
Yeah, it was definitely a different time, different, you really didn't have to do all the things you needed to do now to get attention or to drive a sale. It was really, you know, it was wide open. I mean, my page was horrible. Yeah, if I look back, I wish I had a copy of it. I'd probably go back to the Wayback Machine and see what I wrote on there. And I'd probably be shocked that people actually responded to it.
That'll be fun to see. So what was your background growing up? I mean, were your parents business owners? Did you ever hear people talk about starting your own business? Did anybody ever promote being an entrepreneur to you, or what was the deal with that?
Yeah, actually, I grew up in an entrepreneurial family. My grandfather, who was a big influence in my life and a mentor to me, he owned a chain of shoe stores. And I grew up in those shoe stores learning how to sell, how to relate to customers. But back then, I mean, he kind of did everything on a hope and a whim. There was no structure, you know, he had a very good competitive advantage. He sold name brand shoes at a discount, and people used to line up when he had a sale to come into the store and buy. And he had a lot of famous customers, such as like Whitney Houston. He had a shoe store next to the Meadowlands that served Italian leather shoes that specialized in athletes, big sizes. Have a funny story I could tell you one day about that with the O.J. Simpson trial, because he had all the skews that left a footprint that I guess when he was escaping from the Ferragamo shoes that they often talked about in the trial. And I actually have an autograph from OJ from when he came into the store and the FBI came to visit to try to match up a receipt with the purchase of the shoes. And that could have been the piece of evidence that put him away.
The proverbial smoking gun provided by your grandfather.
Yeah. So I grew up in a very entrepreneurial family, but I also saw the struggles with that of, and this is kind of what led me to where I am today, because I saw how he always struggled with cash flow and how he was always trying to, you know, generate enough money to cover expenses, even though he was very successful and had a whole chain of stores, but he didn't really have anything implemented that would bring in new customers all the time. It was always, you know, having a sale to raise money versus having an automated machine that would be able to turn $1 into $2.
Right. He was not necessarily marketing savvy, but he did a lot of things right, it sounds like.
Oh, yeah. 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 I mean, he didn't have a business education or really any education. He really bootstrapped the whole business from the ground up. And at one point, GE offered him 10,000 stores to run for them, their Shoetown stores. So, I mean, he was doing a lot right. His response to them was, I have trouble running 10 stores. How am I going to run 10,000? So, you know, so it really impressed upon me having systems in place to always bring in new customers so that you could build a business that was sustainable. And that's really what got me into consulting for small businesses after I had some, after my, you know, that what we talked about before, the site Free for Today got defunded basically based on when the market collapsed. I went into consulting and wanted to help other people build a business that was sustainable.
And that was the next step. And how long did you do that?
I did that for a few years, and during those few years, I'll transition into my next part, was that I kept on hearing in the marketing community and in the copywriting world, people talking about something called NLP, neuro-linguistic programming. And it really caught my attention, because I've always been fascinated with how the mind works and why people buy or how to get someone to do an action. And you know, that's really related to direct response marketing, copywriting, sales. Everything is based on, you know, getting someone to believe something and for them to take the next step. And like many people, I went out and took a course on neuro-linguistic programming. And I was like, wow, this stuff is really, really cool. But how do you actually use it in the real world? Because neuro-linguistic programming, if you don't know what that is, was designed for therapeutic applications. The co-owners of NLP, Richard Bandler and Dr. John Grinder, they modeled successful therapists, some of the best communicators in the world. Why these communicators were able to make changes in other people, while when other people communicated with them, they weren't able to make changes. And they looked at how these people were able to communicate, and they developed skills and strategies. They modeled their communication methods and broke them down into different techniques that you can use to get people to change. So while taking this course in NLP, I hired someone privately to teach me, and I asked him, I said, yeah, you know, this is all great stuff and all, but how do I actually use this? I mean, you know, I can use it on myself, or if I want to be a therapist to help people change, that'd be great. And he handed me a CD, that had the name Kendrick Cleveland on it. And I popped that CD into my DVD player when I got back. And that was a pivotal moment in my life. Everything changed from that point forward. I took what I learned that inside this DVD and I started applying it into my business. And I saw my responses just skyrocket. My consulting business, I was, you know, doing probably low six figures, and I jumped up to mid six figures. And I had lines of people waiting to sign up with me because I was able to target my communication right to what mattered most to those people. So after watching that DVD, I quickly signed up for one of Kendrick's courses called The Persuasion Factor. And I started just after listening to a few modules of that, my income just skyrocketed again. And I'm like, okay, now I need to take this to the next level. And I contacted Kendrick, and I learned that he had an advanced coaching program. So, you know, I signed up for his advanced coaching program and we kind of just hit it off. And Kendrick said, you know, we decided to partner up. And that
was it. So this was a personal coaching program. You started working directly with him.
Yes. Yeah. A group and one-on-one. It contained a lesson. I think it was like a lesson or two a month, group calls, and then two one-on-one calls where you can interact with Kendrick And he would help you with the different skills and strategies and help you apply them to your exact situation.
And so you guys hit it off. And, well, long story short, you wound up becoming his partner. But how did that come about? I mean, did he find out what you knew about online marketing and copywriting? Did he propose it? Did you propose it? Was it a joint thing?
Well, like I like to joke with Kendrick, he taught me too well. And I subtly hinted that I was interested in working with him. I wasn't sure if it was going to be a partnership or just working with him in a way to help with marketing and sales. But, you know, the conversation developed and we ended up deciding to partner up. And, you know, I made the decision to get rid of that business I was growing, even though it was like a mid six figure business at that time. I dropped it at an instant because what I loved about working with small businesses was, you know, helping, as I mentioned before, helping them create a lead generation system where they could feel confident and sleep well at night, that they knew that they always had customers coming in. And working with what Kendrick was doing at that time, I could influence and help a lot more people versus working with 10 or 20 people who were paying me $5,000 to $10,000 a month. You know, I could work with 10,000 people. So I instantly took the opportunity, jumped on board, and never looked back. And I think that was about 8 years ago now.
That had to have been interesting because, I mean, you had a guaranteed six figures coming in. So did that make you a little nervous, or were you like, just, nah, screw it, I'm all in?
I was more like, screw it, I'm all in. I always figured, you know, if something didn't work out, I could always go back to consulting. I had that skill set now that I could have conversations with people. And really, from what I learned from Kendrick, I could really just target my communication right at what they wanted. And it was just really one skill set that I learned from him that allowed me to do that. And I spent probably a good month or two just practicing that skill set over and over and over again until it became second nature. And you know, once I kind of got that wired into my head, I realized I would never have a problem selling anyone. It really doesn't matter what you sell, who you're selling. When you know how to elicit someone's values and their criteria, what we call criteria for doing something, you can really move them to yes in any situation. So I wasn't really nervous about that because I knew I could jump in and either restart my consulting business, or if I ever needed a job, I could go sell whatever I wanted to.
That's a good feeling when you have a skill set like that, that you know, hey, you know, really, whatever happens, I'm not going to be sleeping under a bridge and eating out of dumpsters.
Exactly. And I've been there a couple times with failed businesses where I was almost at that point. So I definitely didn't want to go back to that again.
One time when I lived in Miami, now I'm preaching to the choir. That's an expensive city to live in. And things took a really bad turn for the worse down there. And I was walking at Walgreens, and there's this homeless guy sitting outside of Walgreens begging money. And I thought, you know, wow, if things continue like this for the next few months, I'm going to be like sitting right beside him doing the same thing. So it's nice to have a skill set that prevents that.
Yeah. And I think learning how to communicate powerfully and be able to move people to a yes. I mean, is there a more powerful skill set that you can learn? I mean, it affects every single aspect of your life. From daily communications, if you have a boss, or if you're trying to sell something, or if you're trying to write copy, you know, no matter what you do, I mean, in my world, all communication is about influence and persuasion. It all boils down to the point of being able to move someone into the direction you want them to go to see your point of view. So, you know, for me, and that's one of the reasons why I really loved what Kendrick was doing and I had no problem jumping right on board because the possibilities are endless when you start studying this stuff. I mean, it impacts your life in such a way that it's even hard to describe. And, you know, that's one of the things that gives me the most joy is seeing how we impact people and getting people writing to us testimonials, telling us, you know, I had a guy call us or call in, and I answered the phone, and he asked to speak with Kendrick, and Kendrick was busy. And he said, oh, I'm a previous student of his, did some private consulting several years, you know, probably 10 years ago. And I just really wanted to thank Kendrick. We just sold, you know, about a year ago, we sold our business for $500 million. And I credit Kendrick for teaching that, you know, it was sold based on the fact that we had such a strong sales team in place that the company bought it because we were able to convert so many people and we had such a high offering for the company because of that. And I just wanted to thank him. So, you know, stuff like wow. that. Yeah. I mean, when you get that kind of impact on someone, it really drives you and you feel proud of what you're doing, you know, instead of trying just to sell anything.
You know, I'm pretty much a rookie at NLP. I mean, I've read some stuff, but, you know, compared to Kendrick, I'm a rookie. I've got sitting in my to be read stack, Turtles All the Way Down by
Richard Bandler.
Yeah, Bandler, because that was recommended to me. But would you mind just giving a brief neophyte explanation of what NLP is and how somebody could use it in their business or if they're selling something?
Yeah, happy to do so. Well, the first thing I would probably say is don't learn NLP. Because like I mentioned before, it was developed for therapeutic practices and for communicating on a therapeutic level. And that's the way it's taught. And if you think about it, when you're in a therapeutic context, it's different than a normal everyday context. There's different presuppositions. I'm the therapist. You're the patient. I can say whatever I want and you're going to follow along. And that doesn't happen in the real world, does it?
No, if only.
Right. And that's the problem with that I see. And what, you know, we don't teach traditional NLP. That's kind of Kendrick's background of where he came from. He was one of the earliest trainers of NLP under the co-founders. But what he did was when he was learning, and he was back, I think he was 18 years old, so, you know, something like 40 years ago when it was just first being developed, he was also working as in a gym selling. That was kind of his passion, was selling and also hypnosis that led to NLP. And, you know, so he was learning about these types of strategies, and he always jokes around and says, you know, so when I had to sell someone and I started incorporating these techniques, I would have to do therapy on them. I would have to sit there and it would be a 2 or 3 hour conversation to get them to say yes. They would say yes, but it would take that long. So he spent the next decade or so, and or probably actually 4 decades up until now, taking that skill set along with a bunch of others and translating them into the business and everyday world. So we get a lot of people who come to us who have taken NLP courses, just like I did, and who find our, you know, or who get recommended or find us through advertising or through different promotions. And, you know, they have the same response. Wow, I can finally use these skills in the real world. And it really just takes a different frame, some tweaks on being able to use the conversationally to be able to use it in everyday conversation based on shifting a few different aspects of certain skills and strategies. So, you know, my recommendation is I would stay far away from NLP. We basically say that, you know, we do NLP rehab because we have so many people. I was actually going to put up a site on that. I thought that would be a great promotion. But, you know, so NLP is not really what we teach. I mean, we're grounded. We have a lot of different skill sets that get woven into what we do. But at its foundation, yeah, there's a lot of NLP aspects of it.
Oh no, the episode is over, but only for this week. Come on back next week, Canine Crew, to get part 2 of the Jared Eamon episode. We'll see you next time. Canine Crew, before you run off, I want to remind you, Doberman Dan has set up an off-the-chain hotline. Call in, tell us you love us. It's even better if you tell us you hate us. It doesn't matter what you say. All you have to do is call in, leave a message. The number is 321-424-6043. Again, off the chain hotline, 321 424-6043.
This is the PodcastFactory.com.